Low-intensity shockwave therapy is a new form of therapeutic that we are currently investigating for the management of erectile dysfunction. As urologists, we're very familiar with shockwave therapy. In the 80s, we used shockwaves initially for the management of kidney stones. However, as the decades went on, we learned that using low-intensity shockwave therapy could actually be utilized to help with wound healing, to cause revascularization of the heart, as well as treatment of things like diabetic ulcers. So a number of years ago, investigators in Europe started to use low-intensity shockwave therapy to see if we could improve erectile function in men that had severe ED. The thought was is that it could penetrate into the tissue in the penis to help promote additional blood flow and allow there to be more robust erections. The way that this works is really unknown, but we do know that the form of a generation of shocks to the penis is important. So low-intensity shockwave therapy is actually used at the base of the penis as well as on the length of the penis multiple times a week for many weeks to improve blood flow. Currently, it's under investigation, and we're still not sure if this is truly going to be a mainstay treatment for erectile dysfunction.
Well, there's a lot of different types of shockwaves that can be produced. Besides all the complicated physics, the bottom line is that there are certain shock waves, types of waves, that when directed at tissue actually have an effect. And so radial waves don't have the type of effect that we want them to have to cause changes in the penis. And low-intensity shockwave attempts to cause changes in the penis, but whether or not it actually helps or not is yet to be determined.
Yeah, that's probably best delineated in a diagram, to be honest with you. Shockwave therapy has a very short but very high amplitude of the shockwave, and radial wave therapy is much less intense and much longer lasting. There's a lot of confusion in the field because a lot of patients think they're getting shockwave therapy when in fact what they are getting is radial wave therapy, right? The evidence that is used to support shockwave therapy in the treatment of ED is all from shockwave therapy, not radial wave therapy. And you cannot transpose that data to the radial wave.
Well, that's the hot button question here. How effective is this therapy? And the answer is we're still evaluating it. We hope that it will be effective, but more studies are needed.
Well, there's a growing body of evidence that shockwave therapy is doing a very good job for males suffering from erectile dysfunction. And that has been shown in many placebo-controlled trials, so there is no doubt that shockwave therapy is helping men suffering from any kind of erectile dysfunction.
Well, in terms of risks and benefits of low-intensity shockwave therapy, there is the thought here that this is a non-invasive approach to treating erectile dysfunction, and therefore potentially it could be safer being non-invasive, potentially. But we still need to look for efficacy, and this is part of where we are now in the field to evaluate it further.
The good news with the shockwave is that we don't think it hurts anything, so it's very safe. But doing nothing also is very safe. If somebody took a small hammer, one of those squeaky hammers that the kids get, and they hit your penis with it 1,000 times, that probably wouldn't cause any problems either, but it's not going to improve your erections, is it? So at the end of the day, it's safe, but is it effective?
The clinical trials that have looked at the long-term effects of low-intensity shockwave therapy have shown that in men with moderate to severe erectile dysfunction, there is clearly a taper in the response to their erectile function over months to years. At least in a few studies that have investigated this, have not shown that it is durable for long periods of time, in particular over a year. So that begs the question, you know, how do we improve upon this? And that's where there's a number of investigations that are looking at the duration of shocks and the role of maintenance therapy. I think we all acknowledge in the field that low-intensity shockwave therapy may have an effect on erectile function long-term, but we all know that it likely has to be combined with other forms of treatment.
Well, it may, in terms of long-term benefit. I think also that's part of our studies. You know, part of evolving a therapy is to understand the mechanism, the way it works, and the notion here behind this therapy is that it could be restorative, that it potentially can heal the penis, and that's what's so exciting about it. But is it just a short-term effect? Maybe. Can it be a long-term effect? And well, we have to evaluate this. But if it heals some of the tissue by various mechanisms that are proposed and has a durable consequence, well, great, but we have to see.
Meanwhile, in our institute, it's a routine therapy in the same way as oral drug therapy or injectional therapy is doing. So the prime time is passed. It's established in many leading institutes.
And as things stand at the moment, shockwave therapy is being used, and it's as if we're using a drug where we don't know the dose that should be used. We don't know when it should be taken. We don't know what the side effects are. We don't know how beneficial it is. In the trials, in those 16 trials or so, most of them show some benefit. Many of them show minimal benefit. So it's unclear at this point in time if shockwave therapy really should be used. The ISSM, the SMSNA, have a clear statement that it's investigational and should be done within the confines of a trial.
I currently don't use this in my clinical practice because I don't know the frequency and duration of shocks that is going to be most effective for men with erectile dysfunction.
So at this stage, no, we do not recommend low-intensity shockwave therapy because I'm data-driven and there isn't yet enough data that shows to me that the benefit outweighs the potential risks.
It depends on what the patient is suffering from. And in all the patients who are dissatisfied with the outcome of oral drug therapy, and I have investigated these patients and they are suffering from organic reasons, of course I recommend shockwave therapy. I recommend also shockwave therapy in diabetic patients, in hypertensive patients, in those patients who do not like to be on a permanent way on a pill or on injectables, then I recommend them to undergo shockwave therapy. But once more, not in the psychogenic patients.
My key take-home points regarding shockwave therapy is that it's evolving, that it could be an interesting new modality to treat erectile dysfunction. I think we need to do the appropriate studies and be forthright with patients about safety and efficacy to come.
Well, I think meanwhile shockwave therapy should be established in all countries in dealing with sexual medicine. These are all countries. And patients should consider that, and especially the counseling physicians should offer the patients opportunities to undergo shockwave therapy, especially in those patients when they are non-responders. For salvage reasons, in our institute, we could rescue about 50% of non-responders with 6 to 12 sessions for shockwave therapy. So once more, it's a therapy for a broad spectrum of patients with erectile dysfunction.
I think it's a fascinating idea. I think the basic science is crystal clear that it's of some benefit, but we do not yet have large enough randomized controlled trials conducted for long enough with enough knowledge about which machine is best to answer the question.